Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to the West Virginia Entrepreneurship Ecosystem Virtual Symposium on Entrepreneurship Education. I'd like to start by thanking our wonderful partners. The Benedum Foundation, Encova Insurance, and the Appalachian Regional Commission. We're very appreciative of your continued support. A quick background on the entrepreneurship ecosystem. This group started organically with a handful of like-minded service providers from across the state in 2018. Thanks to the hard work of many individuals, shout out Bill Woodrum, today we have over 40 active organizations that all have the same goal in mind, to support entrepreneurs in West Virginia. Today we'll be talking about entrepreneurship education in West Virginia. We are lucky to have a group of dedicated educators like the ones you're about to hear from, including K through 12 and higher education experts, and how it all fits together. And of course, we are proud to be a part of the Global Entrepreneurship Month. So let's get to it. My name is Tara St. Clair. I'm the education program lead here at the Encova Center for Innovation and Entrepreneurship at the John Chambers College of Business and Economics, and I will be your MC for today. I'd like to start by introducing Dr. Jean Colson, who is the executive director at EntreRed, the Consortium for Entrepreneurship Education. Welcome, Jean. Would you like to say a few words?
Well, it's exciting to be here with you. I think this entrepreneurship ecosystem program has been an important one, and I'm pleased to be part of it, not just on this presentation, but a number of the other activities. And Tara and Bill, I'm really appreciative that you asked me to be a part of this.
Thank you, Gene. We're happy to have you here today. All right. Next, we have Deanna Canterbury Penn, who is the coordinator for the West Virginia Department of Education CTE. Hi, Deanna. How are you? Deanna, you might be on mute.
I apologize for that. Hi, how are you guys? Thank you for inviting the panel to be a part of West Virginia's larger entrepreneurial ecosystem ensures all stakeholders are engaging in conversations of entrepreneurial development. So I'm glad to be here. Thanks for inviting me.
We're glad to have you. All right, next we have Dr. Laura McCullough, who serves as the Vice President of Community and Corporate Education at Bridge Valley. Hello, Laura.
Hi, Tara. I'm honored to be here, and I'm honored to participate in the ecosystem. I think it's a good group, and I do get a lot out of connecting with others. So looking forward to today's presentation.
All right. Okay, and finally, we have Dr. Ben Ng, who is now the Assistant Professor of Marketing and Entrepreneurship at Marshall University. Ben, how are you, my friend?
Doing great, Tara. Nice to see you as well, and a pleasure to be on this amazing panel with all my great friends on here, and I'm really excited to talk about entrepreneurship and innovation today.
All right, fantastic. So thank you all for being here today, and we are looking forward to your expertise. So let's jump right into it. I've prepared a couple of questions for you guys, and we will start with question one. Pivoting and innovating are common words you hear when you start to talk about entrepreneurship. During these trying times, many people have had to make some dramatic pivots and start thinking in new ways. So Jean, let's start with you. How has entrepreneurship education for your organization been affected by COVID?
Well, I would say that a year ago, our model was to deliver entrepreneurship education to every teacher, every student in a building. And the way we did that is generally through face-to-face teacher training. We had some good partnerships with community colleges who would bring in K-12 teachers from their region, and we would do face-to-face training. And that was working pretty well. Our funding sponsors were happy with the results. But of course, first the kids went home, and then the teachers went home, and then the community college members went home. And so for us, we pivoted to taking the training that we had put together and putting it into an online format that we could deliver as a course online. And we called that our tier one training. And as we move through this last several months, we've also developed a tier two training, which is an advanced training that teaches any kind of teacher from elementary to high school in every subject area how to integrate entrepreneurship into their math class or science class or English class or third grade class. Then as we were working on those two projects and getting them ready to put online, we found that we had these pieces of lessons that we kind of liked that might be better directed to students directly. So we developed a course called Learn to Launch. And Learn to Launch is a series of 10 lessons that students can come online and use themselves to train themselves on how to start a business. It's aimed at middle to high schoolers, or teachers can use Learn to Launch in an online format to work with their students. So teachers can lead them through it, or the students can do it directly. And now we have taken all three of those online format programs and packaged them together so schools can purchase the whole package and make all of those available to all of their students and all of their teachers. And we're a long way in a different direction than where we were a year or 10 months ago. But I think it's healthier for us, because I believe when these new vaccines we're hearing about finally come to the fore and we're all cured and COVID goes away, fingers crossed, we may stay with this. We miss being face-to-face with our teachers, but this has allowed us to reach well beyond the number of teachers that we were working with. And it also allows the teachers to get the training at their leisure, or when they ever have leisure these days. So that's kind of how we have had to pivot from face-to-face to online format. But I think it's been good for us. It's been stressful, but it's been good. And I think it will be good for us as we move forward post-COVID. Thanks.
Great. Thank you, Gene, for that. And this is just a friendly reminder, if you have questions throughout this presentation, please ask them in the Q&A box, and we will address them at the end of the presentation. Next, Deanna, what pivots have you and your organization had to make during COVID?
Well, as we know, just like Gene suggested and talked about, the inability of certain counties to meet face-to-face has really gave teachers and students to find a new and creative way to actually communicate. And here at West Virginia Department of Education, we use Teams. And just this past weekend, DECA, which is one of our 8 career technical student organizations that we have, conducted their fall leadership virtually in a conference over Teams. Students were engaged for 2 hours each day from 5:30 to 7:30, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. And then one of the sessions was a quick pitch contest. So on Friday, they were given the criteria. On Saturday, worked together in groups in breakout sections. And then even though the participation is down compared to face-to-face, the students and advisors make virtual work. So it has been a really huge pivot in order to get the students involved virtually. And especially, like I said, with DECA, it was on the weekend, but the students enjoyed themselves. And again, the attendance was down, but the ones that were there were very, very much enjoyed, the interaction with the students virtually. So that's one thing that we had to move to. And we all know that we're just making it work. The students and the teachers, they're struggling every day, but they're just trying to come up to par and trying to work out with the students all the glitches. And I'm sure that the students are learning from the teachers and the teachers are learning from the students as well. We developed also, we're in the process of developing a entrepreneurship pathway. Most of our programs of study here in career and technical education consist of four courses where a student becomes a completer in that particular program of study. So we are piloting starting in the 21-22 school year, an entrepreneurship pathway that is going to come off of a business management and administration cluster. And those particular courses are going to be like a business marketing essentials course, as well as a applications in computers. And then we're going to have like a introduction to entrepreneurship, as well as an advanced entrepreneurship. And we are getting a lot of feedback from, like, for example, I just had a meeting this morning with Dr. Ng, and we're getting a lot of feedback from the universities, as well as a six panels of panel of teachers that are actually, a couple of them had their own business, and that we are learning from them to get the skill sets that we need to give these kids to have entrepreneurship skills.
Excellent. Thank you, Deanna. So up next, Laura, has your organization made any adjustments during COVID?
Sure. Yes, we have. When we first started in March, this the pandemic happened right around our spring break. And so we sent all the students home and then asked them to quarantine for 2 weeks. And then we brought them back. And just about everybody was back online, either through our learning management platform, Blackboard, or through Teams or Zoom. We started out saying we wanted to do Teams, but the faculty didn't really embrace that as well as they have Zoom. So we're using that as like hybrid instruction, but we also have online resources. For example, we use the Kauffman Foundation Fast Track as the basis for a lot of our non-credit training, and we even use it in our for-credit training, our education. And so, you know, the students will do some of their work on the platform, the Kauffman platform, but then we'll meet weekly through Zoom or, you know, the teleconference platform, and they'll have guest speakers, and then we add some extra things to it. So it's just not the Kauffman Foundation. You know, we also do some forecasting with the students individually and help them really finalize their business plans. But you know, who we mainly work with are just the baby, the beginners, the people that are still in the ideation stage of business development. So, and we found that it hasn't mattered, that Zoom is very convenient. I mean, people are a lot of times still working their regular job and then trying to launch their business on the quick. And Zoom once a week seems to work really well. So that's what we're doing.
Excellent. Thank you, Laura. And Ben, how are you and the Marshall Innovation Team handling this situation?
Thanks for first of all, I want to thank everybody, the West Virginia Entrepreneurship Ecosystem, for having me, and the audience for joining in as well. And also to my great friend, partner in crime and colleague, Tara St. Clair, for moderating this panel. Really wanted to start off by thanking everyone for that. But yeah, to answer the question about how higher ed has been impacted, or specifically at Marshall, I think maybe it's probably helpful to start by giving all the context of what I'm teaching. So all the educators out there, because there might be different situations, depending on the level people are teaching. So I'll talk about the circumstances and the context that I'm teaching in, and maybe you can tell, the educators at home can tell the similarities and differences to their situation. So this semester at Marshall, I'm teaching three different groups. The first group are college freshmen, and I'm delivering that course in a hybrid format where they can either attend class face-to-face, old school, I guess now, or online. And I'm also teaching a second group, which are MBA students, and I'm teaching them in a synchronous online format, which means we meet online live at a specific time where we all meet live. And then lastly, I'm teaching entrepreneurship to a cohort of aspiring administrative leaders at Marshall in a synchronous online format. So, a big variety of different types of students and in a couple different formats as well. So here are some, I guess, takeaways from my experience and as well as talking to other professors about their experiences. So the first thing I think is it's always good to start with what hasn't changed, because I always think this is really important. So even before COVID, I always felt that the best way to teach something, regardless if it's entrepreneurship or marketing or soccer or cooking, is to have students try to solve a real problem in whatever area that I'm trying to teach them in. So Elon Musk always calls this teaching to the problem rather than teaching the tools. So teaching to the problem rather than teaching the tools. And the way I like to think about it is this. So let's say you wanted to teach like a student Spanish. You can have them either read a textbook on Spanish and then do homework based on those concepts from the Spanish textbook, or you could take them to Spain. And when they're in Spain, they have a host of problems that they'll need to solve, like how to order food, how to ask where the restroom is, how to read street signs. And one tool that would be great at solving those problems is learning how to speak Spanish. So teaching to the problem allows students to understand why the tools are relevant, because then they organically see the need for the tools, right? Because it's like you need the tools to solve the problem. So now they know why Spanish, like learning Spanish in the first place, is important. And by the way, you know, teaching to the problem also allows them to innovate new ways to solve the problem. So maybe they'll innovate a new app that translates Spanish in a better way than the current translator app. So even during these COVID times, I'm always trying to find ways to take my students to Spain. So as for what has changed, first, I learned that a student's learning environment is far more complex than I originally anticipated. Obviously, I knew that they would have to adjust to learning how to, like, you know, navigate through the online mediums and click all the right buttons and all that. But the challenge, I guess, I didn't predict was, and this has been far more difficult, is their home environment, where they're logging in from. So, you know, pre-COVID, the classroom was the one place where students could learn free of distractions. And now, you know, students might have dogs barking, a vacuum cleaner going off in the family room. Maybe their dad, you know, hey, you got to move the grass. You know, just all sorts of stuff can be happening in the background. And also because students are logging in from their homes, students at Marshall have been encouraged to turn their videos off for their video feeds off for privacy reasons. So, you know, some students may not want to share with me or other students how they live or where they live. And it's important to protect their privacy. So, you know, I never ask them to turn their videos on. You know, the downside of this, of course, is that, you know, if in addition to the distractions, but also the lack of a camera feed on their end, you know, it makes engagement a lot more difficult than ever before. At least that's what I found. But what's mitigated this challenge is that students who are disengaged or distracted by something in their home environment can now catch up later because the classes are recorded. So there was a student in my hybrid course who didn't attend a single live class, either face-to-face or online, except for the first class. They were there for the first one, and then that was it. And the whole semester, I was like, oh my gosh, you know, where's this kid? But then it came time for our big presentation that we had. And I was thinking, I don't know if this kid's gonna do very well. And he gave one of the best presentations of the class because he watched all the recordings on his own time. I was just thinking, man, if this was a face-to-face class, he probably would have failed the class, but because he could watch it on his own time, you know, probably get an A. We'll see, there's still some semester left. But another change that I noticed is that students are having a much more difficult time meeting new friends in virtual class. And that's a concern of mine, not only because these students aren't only losing out on meeting new friends, but also they're missing out on potential future networking opportunities. But what's mitigated that challenge is that the virtual learning environment is a gateway to the world. I can bring in experts from around the globe to meet and teach my students. Students can validate their business ideas with customers anywhere rather than just at the student center or at the library. And my MBA students actually are part of this program called MBA Response, where they solve business problems for companies all over North America. One group's working like with a company in Canada, and they're partnering with students from Harvard and Northwestern and University of Chicago, which, you know, now creates amazing networking opportunities for them. So finally, I wanted to leave all the educators out there with something that struck a chord in me recently. A couple weeks ago, I was watching a YouTube video with Jeff Bezos, who of course is the CEO of Amazon, and the host asked him, you know, hey Jeff, why do you love working at Amazon? And his response was, because I get to work in the future. And even though, you know, Jeff Bezos equated the future with technology, his answer applies to us as educators as well. You know, we get to work in the future too. And while Jeff Bezos gets to create the next generation of technology, we get to create the next Jeff Bezos, the next Brad Smith, the next John Chambers. Now more than ever, I think it's really important to remember that we work in the future. The future of West Virginia is in our hands. And it's really easy to get caught up in the present moment with all the challenges that COVID presents. There's no doubt that in the present moment, school from anywhere can be a frustrating adjustment for both our students and for us. But all the effort that we're putting in to make this transition happen is critically important, because school from anywhere is preparing our students to thrive in a future of work from anywhere. I think the transition towards work from anywhere could be the most significant industrial revolution of our lifetimes, if you think about it. The other revolutions, they changed the way we worked in our companies, but this revolution will change the way we also live in our homes. And because of that future, the world will need people with a whole new skill set than ever before. For example, the ability to focus on work regardless of a dog barking or a vacuum cleaner going off in the room. The ability not just to have time management skill, but also great work-life balance skills. Studies have shown that productivity is way up. Productivity is way up with work from anywhere, but so is remote burnout. So all of these are all things that we can help students learn how to manage now in our virtual class. And I'll leave you with this. I once heard Brad Smith say, you know, change can happen to us or change can happen through us, but either way, change is inevitable. So I think if we can embrace and set new standards on school from home, it'll be West Virginia students that will define the future of business and entrepreneurship.
Thank you, Ben. That was great. Very insightful. All right, so we're going to switch gears a little bit here and talk about looking at the overall entrepreneurship ecosystem in West Virginia. We've tried to build a pipeline from K through 12 into a career or continuing on to higher education. We all know that there's a lot of work between ideation and going to market. So I'll start with you, Jean. Can you talk a little bit about some of the examples and how we're working together to link that entrepreneurship ecosystem in the K through 12 space?
Well, I guess we all know now who it is you don't want to follow on a panel like this. Well, really nice job, Ben. I enjoyed your talk there. EntreEd focuses on the K-12 schools, and we kind of feel like the at higher ed, entrepreneurship education is a growing market. It's a growth market. There, almost every community college and university has a new center for something, or a new major or minor, or lots of courses. They're running away with this. What we've discovered is that has not totally been the case in the K-12 area. And we believe that it's important to deliver entrepreneurship to students at their youngest age, that when young kids are finding out what a fireman does and what a policeman does, they ought to know what an entrepreneur does as well. And those skills ought to build throughout their 12-year experience, so that when they graduate and they go off to Dr. McCullough's program or Dr. Ng's program, they have some background, they have some foundation, and maybe they've already started a business or two. So that's kind of why we feel it's important to start that pipeline at the very early ages. Our economy needs more entrepreneurs. We hope to get some started through our programs that perhaps students don't go to post-secondary opportunities. A lot of the students that go through Deanna's programs in career and technical education have a set of skills that they could certainly go out and sell in the marketplace. And what we want is that all the CTE students know that they can take those skills and go work for somebody else, but they can also take those skills and work for themselves, start their own business. And I think that just sort of doubles the career opportunities that students have when they look at career pathways with that eye of either working for somebody else or working for themselves, or during their lifetime, perhaps both. So we want to get started early. We want all of our students to know about entrepreneurship. And the way we do this is we have a school designation called America's Entrepreneurial Schools, or AES. And what we do is we offer two schools the opportunity that their school could be named an America's Entrepreneurial School if they will just find a way to deliver entrepreneurship education to all of the students in their building. And that could be an elementary or a middle or a high school. You see here on the screen a banner that we present to all the America's Entrepreneurial Schools when they complete. And we try to do this with the students present and make a big deal out of it. And then the banner hangs in their school. And it keeps that entrepreneurial focus right up front with students and with teachers. We don't require that every student do a business plan, but we do feel that the schools, with our help, can find a way to reach every student in their building. So that's why we feel it's important to start as early as possible. And I will tell you, if you could be with me in some of these elementary schools and see what the kindergartners and first graders are doing with entrepreneurship, it just makes you smile and warm your heart. And it's excellent. It's excellent work. And so as students move through their 12 or 13 year experience, they have that foundation that they carry with them, whether it's into employment or into post-secondary. We want them to know as much about entrepreneurship as they do anything else. And so that's why we want to start early, and the America's Entrepreneurial Schools is frankly the vehicle that we use right now. So I'll wait for questions about that when we get to the end.
Thank you, Gene. Yeah, I love how you were talking about the foundation. That's what we're building to try and send them through that pipeline. So I think that leads nicely into Deanna. Can you talk about the pipeline that's being created within your organization with the CTE program?
I just wanted to say that first, that I'm very proud to be part of the board for EntreEd. They offer resources for our teachers that are just invaluable to use. And every year they have a forum where teachers come. And like I said, it's been wonderful to work with Gene and EntreEd. So a couple of things that I want to talk about. Last school year, there were six schools piloting a program that's called Virtual Enterprise. And we call it VE. And the classrooms were transferred into career incubators for students. And across the state, it may look a little bit different now because of being virtual, but these virtual enterprise students actually work internationally with other programs to build their own business in groups at their schools. And then they share even by all the skill sets they've learned so far with all the teacher, with all students and their particular businesses across the state. So the students fill departmental roles mirroring real world careers, and lots of hands-on learning took place inside and outside the classroom. And this year we have 10 VE classrooms across the state, and it may look a little different because of the virtual environment, but the skill sets are still being met. And on my slide, you can see that I'm talking about the next thing is high school business plan competition. This is the 8th annual West Virginia statewide high school business plan competition. And it looks a little different this year because in the past, we've always done it at different places across the state. And of course, now the students are going to have to present virtually. And While the events cannot be in person this year, we have created a virtual space that allows the energy and enthusiasm, ideas, and sharing to thrive. The West Virginia State High School Business Plan Competition offers high school students around the state the unique opportunity to make their business idea come to life. Participants come from many different disciplines and backgrounds, and the competition is open to all juniors and seniors from any high school in the state of West Virginia. And this year's competition will be 100% online and be open to for-profit and non-for-profit ideas. It's actually taking place now, and the first finals come up around December 4th, and the winners will be announced throughout the school year. So the high school business plan competition is a great opportunity for the students just to pitch their ideas and get investors involved, as well as possible college scholarships. Another thing that I have listed on my slide is the Governor's School of Entrepreneurship. I have links for both ideas and both opportunities that are there. And unfortunately, this past summer, the particular Governor's School of Entrepreneurship had to be canceled because of the pandemic. But usually every year, around 50 students come involved in this particular program. And they spend 3 weeks learning what it takes to be an entrepreneur. So the link is there. And like I said, the next one will be summer of 2021. So for you educators that are out there, please share both of these ideas with your students. And then I've already talked a little bit about SWEEP. I told you that we were actually developing a program of study for entrepreneurship off of the Business Administration and Business Management Administrative Career Cluster. So we are going to start piloting that in the next school year. We have a lot of partners coming involved in this initiative that is helping us. Like I said previously, there are teachers that are involved. We have Entrepreneurship Ecosystem that's involved, and we hope to make it a very successful opportunity for our students, all these programs.
Thank you, Deanna. Sounds like there's a lot of great partnerships going on through the Department of Education, which leads us next into Laura. If you could please talk to us about the entrepreneurship ecosystem that's been built in the two-year education.
Sure. Well, as most people know, the community and technical college system has primarily been focused on workforce training efforts. We give people technical skills and they use those and they go and get a job. Well, under Bridge Valley leadership, we started looking at the economy and the numbers of big companies that are out there that are hiring our students as employees, and realized that a great deal of them were replacement workers and there wasn't a whole lot of growth. And so we thought we were doing our students a disservice if we didn't give them the ability to grow their own job, to create their own job. So yes, we still, and you know, that's what we excel at, training, you know, giving technical skills. So a welder, for example, you know, yes, we teach welding and produce a lot of really good welders. But we also hope, and it's an aspirational goal, that that they will also learn how to have their own welding business. And I think that's what West Virginia needs in order to diversify its economy. And a positive outcome, I think, of the pandemic has been that entrepreneurship has been on the increase in West Virginia. I mean, we had one of the lowest entrepreneurship rates in the country, and now we, you know, have had seen a lot of growth in that area. So we're really happy. So, you know, at Bridge Valley, we've had a couple of multi-prong approach. We have the grid at in Montgomery, and it's an experiential learning area. It is a lot of maker spaces. There's woodworking shop, there's pottery, there's, you know, a long arm quilting machine, there's textiles, there's brewing, there's digital production, a lot of stuff that people need to run small production runs or to the back side of a business. But we also teach Kauffman Foundation courses to get people started in their journey of creating a business. So that's what we're doing on the non-credit side. But on the academic side, we used to do, we had two degrees. We had an associate degree, a two-year degree, and a one-year certificate degree in entrepreneurship. And we had very low enrollment because it just wasn't meeting the entrepreneur's need. I mean, you don't want to start a business, and before you do, you take 60 hours of college credit. So we looked at how we do that, and we've incorporated it into a technical studies degree program. We started a degree program called Canine Train the Trainer, where we're teaching people how to have dog businesses, whether you're training for different types of service dogs or protection dogs, or maybe you're managing a kennel. But so we have that kind of a formal degree, but in the middle is all about how to be an entrepreneur, because that's what you're doing, is having to manage that business successfully. We also have a culinary arts program. We just approved it last week. And it is very much incorporating all of the technical skills that you need, to be a baker or butcher or whatever. And you also incorporate it, the entrepreneurship into that. So, for example, in the first year, students would have professional kitchen essentials and fundamentals of entrepreneurship. And then you'd have like food safety, sanitation, culinary, leadership, and HR, menu engineering and cost management, techniques and planning courses and prep courses, but you'd also have funding your venture and opportunity analysis. So, we just have incorporated in those two degrees entrepreneurship into that. But, aspirationally, we would like to do that for all of our degree programs. And, until then, we just promote that we do the entrepreneurship on the non-credit side, and any students, these classes don't cost anything, and students can take them and, think about launching, their own business and have their own jobs as opposed to working for someone else. So, and we rely on, as I mentioned before, we really work with most founders that are in their ideation stage, and we help hold their hand and get them started, and then we refer them to our partners. And we've got a really close relationship with Faster West Virginia, that the Advantage Valley does, a Hive, in the New River Gorge region, Entre Ed, and we've had foundation support. And if whatever our students need, we're going to pass them on and refer them on to, people that can help them the best. So. So that's how we work together to link the entrepreneurship ecosystem.
Great. Thank you, Laura. Mm-hmm. Okay, so for the second question, we are going to finish it out with Ben. Ben, could you please speak to some of the entrepreneurship ecosystems that you have built at the university level, and how are you partnering with folks from across the state?
I guess maybe before, I mentioned the initiatives that we're working with all our partners on, I think it might be helpful to kind of talk about what we believe, what at the iCenter, the Center of Innovation that we have down at Marshall, what we believe is the purpose of education. I think that will help sort of help people understand sort of why we're doing what we're doing. So we're really big believers that the purpose of education really isn't about like downloading content into students' heads. I think the big question is what happens after they graduate and we're not there to download content in their heads anymore. Do they stop learning? We hope not. We want them to continue to learn, adapt, and evolve as they go through life and their career. So I think one of our jobs is to teach content for sure. I mean, that's one of our jobs as educators. But I think the far more important job is inspiring curiosity in students that never leaves them, and teaching them to be lifelong learners well after they leave our classrooms. The idea of lifelong learning is really, really important and to us. And so we view the entrepreneurship pipeline that we're all building together here in the ecosystem as a mechanism that allows students of all ages to be lifelong learners of entrepreneurship. So at the I Center, you know, this is really our mission. You know, we inspire the inner entrepreneur in everyone so that we can reframe the future of West Virginia through entrepreneurship and innovation. And to accomplish this mission, we have entrepreneurship programming at four levels: elementary education, secondary education, higher education, and continuing education. And of course, like, this is a lot of ground to cover. And, you know, our expertise is in higher education. So these other areas, you know, we rely on an amazing set of partners and friends in the ecosystem when we try to make an impact in those areas, because we could never do this ourselves, you know, because we're not as familiar as the experts, as you have seen it, like, on the panel. So, you know, we have people that are constantly sharing best practices and brainstorming with us and partnering with us to help us create this, like, lifelong learning of entrepreneurship. So people like Brad Smith and Intuit, Virtual Enterprise, who Deanna mentioned, the West Virginia Department of Education, Adventure, WVU, Standwatch Academy, EntreEd, all these people are people we're constantly learning from and exchanging best practices from and creating programs with. So with that, you know, what are some of the programs that we do? So I'll just kind of touch a little bit on each one of those four levels. So the first level is the elementary ed, and we don't do as much here, but we really, really enjoy doing it. It's like fun to teach younger students, as Gene mentioned. We do this workshop with the Girl Scouts, where they receive badges in innovation, entrepreneurship, and social entrepreneurship. And it's actually our favorite thing we do all year, because the Girl Scouts are the most creative group we work with, regardless of age. And honestly, it's not even close. They're so creative, it's unbelievable. So we do some there. At the secondary education level, you know, Deanna really already kind of talked about a lot of the things that we're partnering with her on. Career and Technical Education and Governor's School of Entrepreneurship are two biggest ventures. So for the CTE, as Deanna mentioned, we provide thought leadership to Adventure and the CTE as they develop out their business and entrepreneurship curriculum that she mentioned through SWEEP. And we're also working with the CTE on the development of a new certification that involves CTE students building tiny homes that are eco-friendly and sustainable. So that'll be really cool. As for Governor's School, this summer we'll be virtually teaching entrepreneurship and innovation to 60 of West Virginia's best and brightest high school students. And, that'll be just an amazing and immersive relationship. But, you know, hopefully we get to take into Spain, right? The idea, not literally, but, you know, in the metaphor I was using before. And this baton was handed to us from WVU, who's done an amazing job, and Tara done an amazing job with it the last 3 years. So we hope to be able to continue that. At the higher education level, we reinvented a class called Introduction to Business, where our freshman students learn design thinking and about each functional area of business through the lens of starting their own business. And we also have a new initiative for our entrepreneurship major and minor, spearheaded by Professor Olin York, called Jewel City Jumpstart. And what Jewel City Jumpstart is it provides our entrepreneurship students with mentoring and pre-seed capital from angel investors. They actually work with them in the classroom. So that's really neat. And we've also recognized the need to spread innovation and entrepreneurship throughout the Marshall campus. So I mentioned this earlier, but we provide design thinking training to the next group of aspiring administrative leaders in Marshall. So that way, Marshall itself can become more agile to change as change happens, which obviously now it's like, a massive change with COVID. So And finally, but like one of the things I want to mention about the things we do in higher ed is partnering with WVU on student pitch competitions. Both of us have competitions that are open to all students from 2 and 4 year colleges in West Virginia. So our competition is called the West Virginia Business Model Competition, and it's aimed at students with early stage startup ideas. And this competition feeds into WVU's business plan competition, which is aimed at students, college students with more developed startup ideas. And together, we host Bridging Innovation, which is a showcase of the two competitions. It's the finals of the business model competition and the finals of the business plan competition. Unfortunately, last year was canceled due to COVID, and it was going to be our big inaugural year, but it'll be back this year virtually in April. So we're really looking forward to that. And finally, at the continuing education level, like I said, lifelong learning, like after they graduate college, we provide training, workshops, and individual coaching to the startups of the Brad D. Smith Incubator. We always help out people, local businesses, mom and pop shops that are located in the Huntington community. And we partner with the Huntington Chamber of Commerce to do these types of programs. So overall, it's just an incredibly exciting time here in the state. And I'd like to thank all of our partners and friends for working with us to reframe the future of West Virginia through innovation and entrepreneurship.
Sorry, Ben, I was having trouble get off mute. Okay, yeah, I agree. I think you are right. It's a very exciting time for innovation, entrepreneurship in the state of West Virginia. And I'd just like to throw out a reminder, if you guys have any questions, please throw them in the question and answer chat. We're just going to go over a couple more slides and then we will be taking questions. So I just wanted to say I'm very thankful to everyone who has donated their time here with us today. We're very lucky to have a committed group of educators like yourself doing amazing things across the state. Today, we heard about some incredible programs such as the Learn to Launch, the Governor's School of Entrepreneurship. We also heard about ways that everyone is contributing to entrepreneurship in this education pipeline. So through these continued efforts and entrepreneurship, through the entrepreneurship ecosystem, we'll continue to evolve and elevate. So if you have questions and you are unable to get them asked today, please feel free to email any of our speakers. One more time, we would just like to thank our funding partners, the Benedum Foundation, the Incova Insurance, and the ARC. And then finally, we'd like to just take these last couple minutes to make sure that you are aware of ways to become engaged with the entrepreneurship ecosystem. To join our monthly calls, you can go to our website, which is listed on this slide, and you can register. And then it looks like we have a question. If you go to the chat, you can find all of our social media handles. We're on Twitter, we're on Facebook, and we are on LinkedIn. So Ben, I'm gonna start with a question for you. And sorry, I'm just throwing that out here for you. So you have a very strong partnership with Intuit. So maybe you could talk a little bit about the background on that, what it means for you and what it means for the entire state. And do you have any exciting announcements that you can share with us?
So I guess like the history of it, it's really kind of interesting. Well, you know, obviously Brad Smith is an alum and it kind of starts with that story. But it's also a story of like one of my students. So one of my students, I think it was the first or second year I was actually teaching at Marshall, was a student named Izzy Rogner, and she was a marketing student, and she was a student in my marketing class, and she ended up working at Intuit. And you know, when she started working at Intuit, her and Brad put their heads together and they said, hey, you know, it'd be really cool if we took this thing that we do down here in Silicon Valley called design thinking, and you know, we partner with Marshall in some way to spread design thinking down there. So Izzy called me up and she's like, hey, you know, we'd like to do this. And so we created this competition, a design thinking competition, and ended up getting you know, it's kind of like a Shark Tank thing, but we didn't necessarily want sharks there. We wanted like people from West Virginia. So Brad, Jennifer Gardner, Chad Pennington were the three judges for this. And, you know, that ended up sort of bringing design thinking into Marshall and getting the ball rolling on that whole thing. And then after it was over, we were sort of thinking like, hey, you know, what do we do next? How do we follow this one up? You know, like we can't like get Jennifer Garner here every single day. I don't think it'd be cool, but I don't think it's going to happen. So like, how do we take it one step further? And, you know, I think that competition planted the seed of design thinking, but then, you know, to spread it all out, you know, we're like, how do we blast design thinking across all of West Virginia? You know, it was like, all right, let's create the iCenter to do that. So that's sort of like why, you know, like, you know, we're at the four levels of education, trying to share that knowledge of best practices we have with as many people as we can so we can transform West Virginia as fast as we can. So that's sort of like the history behind it all. As for announcements, I can't remember the date. I think it's this Friday. There'll be a really interesting workshop for students. A design thinking workshop where the Intuit people Their education team will be teaching design thinking to a group of, I think, 150 students in the Small Businesses Big Solutions Conference that'll be happening this Friday.
Excellent. Thank you, Ben. Yep. This question is to Laura. How are you trying to deal with the real world, not just theory, but practice? Do you have any great examples?
Sure. I think I would point to the grid, which is, you know, that collection of makerspaces that we have in Montgomery, and that we hope that people have a business idea, and or they have a hobby, or they're really good at something, and we want to teach them how to earn a living by doing that. So maybe they're a woodworker, but they don't have, you know, woodworking equipment is so expensive. And so, you know, they can use our facility for very affordable rate. I think right now the membership rate is $200 for the whole year, and that's 24/7 access. So you can come into our facility and you can, you know, build your product, okay? But now what are you gonna do? So we also teach you some e-commerce skills. We also at the grid have little retail shops that you can rent for like the cost of utilities, so it's nothing. And you can use that as a showcase, or you could have a studio or a office, you know, space in the grid, because it's 80,000 square feet of nothing but possibilities. But we also, you know, can teach you how to do podcasting and how to do web design. And we also have a gallery. So we'll teach you how to exhibit your work. There's many ways to monetize what you do. And so that's really what we're focused on at the grid, is how to make that very practical and try to help. You know, West Virginia has had, you know, such a history of our culture or artistic expression, you know, quilt making or basket weaving or anything really, woodworking. And we do it better than anyone, and that's our tradition. But, you know, how we want to teach people how they can put those skills to benefit themselves and to diversify their community. You know, so maybe they launch their line, product line from the grid. You know, then we, you know, turn them over to, you know, somebody who can help provide, you know, some office space or some retail space, and or maybe they just work virtually for a while. It's so different now that COVID, I mean, we've moved before COVID. The possibilities are endless. I mean, you're not just marketing your work, your products to West Virginia, you know, your competition is the whole world. And so it's pretty exciting.
Great, thank you so much, Laura. Mm-hmm. All right, so we have another question, and this is, how do EntreEd and the West Virginia Department of Education connect high school students to higher education entrepreneurship resources or entrepreneurship service providers if they aren't moving on to higher education? In other words, if there is a continuum of connecting students through the various levels of education. So, Jean, do you want to take this one, or Deanna?
Yeah, I don't mind jumping in here. I think the answer has to do with all the opportunities that are available at higher ed and also at places like the grid and through the small business development centers that are operated by the state. There are lots of opportunities after they get out of high school. What we hope to do is, while they're still in middle school, high school, make sure they know about those opportunities. So when they plan their career path, if it includes college and they know they want to be an entrepreneur, maybe Marshall looks better to them, or WVU looks better because of the opportunities, than some other places that might not have those opportunities. If it doesn't include higher ed, we want them to know about the SBDCs and the grid and places like that. And I think part of the problem that we have, not just in West Virginia, but nationally, is so much of the support for entrepreneurs starts when an adult steps forward and says, I have an idea. And we're doing less to get adults to that point where they have an idea and they have the confidence and they know what to do next. So I think the work that Deanna and I are doing makes students, helps students learn more about what the next steps can be, rather than letting them graduate from high school and say, okay, now what, relative to entrepreneurship. So I hope that answers your question.
Well, Jean, and maybe Deanna wants to jump in on this one as well. I have another question here about the SWEEP, the Simulated Workplace Entrepreneurship Education Pathway, and its connection with Marshall and the entrepreneurship system as a whole. And if you guys could talk about maybe the entrepreneurs and residents that will be going into the Brad Smith Incubator. So I guess that could be Ben, Jean, or Deanna answering on that one.
Deanna, do you want me to take that one, or do you want to, like, either way?
Sure, go ahead. I can hop in. Go ahead.
Okay. Yeah, you can fill in any gaps that I might leave out. The entrepreneurs and residents, it's our inaugural class, so it's like it's a brand new thing. And what you know, you guys might have heard of like executive in residence, and what that typically, what an executive in residence is a business person, a prominent business person with a lot of expertise will come to a campus and just share their expertise with faculty and students, staff, just everybody. And an entrepreneur in residence is very similar, you know. So we, you know, for us at the iCenter and in the entrepreneurship department and business school, we have entrepreneurs who are experts in certain fields to help provide us expertise in areas that we want to learn and our students need and all that. So, and not just Marshall students, but obviously also like, you know, the simulated workplace students and the CTE students and the startups, the incubators. So just all our different stakeholders and the customers that we serve. So the entrepreneurs and residents that we named this year, our first ones are Colin Meadows, who is at a company that he started called Tech 304. And what Tech 304 is, it's a company that helps entrepreneurs with ideas like apps and software ideas. He helps them develop those apps and software. So just a really, really prodigious talent and great person. And then our second EIR is Brandon Dennison from Coalfield Development. And maybe most people here have heard of Brandon Dennison and Coalfield Development, but he's one of the leading social entrepreneurs in the world. And he's from right here. And he's Coalfield Development was a company that trained coal miners in other areas so that way they could learn new jobs and new trades and all that. So he's bringing a lot of expertise in from the social entrepreneurship side. And again, those will all be, all that expertise will funnel down to all our different people that we teach, including the SWEEP grant and simulated workplace students. Deanna, how did I do? Did I leave anything out there?
That's perfect, Ben. I wanted to also add that we have the entrepreneurship skill sets that we are trying to develop for this program of study. We eventually want to incorporate them in all of the programs of study in CTE. And I noticed that Zach, I think, asked a question about if it should be a skill set entrepreneurship or a bachelor's degree. I thought that was pretty interesting because, like you said, all of our CTE programs of study are usually skills, and some of the students want to have those entrepreneurship skill sets to develop their own business. And what we want to do in CTE is make that happen for the students.
Thank you, Deanna. I think that's a great way to wrap it up. We are at right at 3:00. So I want to say again, thank you to everyone. I appreciate your time, and I hope that you join in on our monthly calls and become engaged. So have a great day.